Okay, so we are going to lecture 7, and this content is already covered in our preview lecture 6.5. I will just repeat it in this live streaming. So up to now, we have considered the solution of Poisson equation. We wanted to solve it. So Poisson equation is the simplest one we can consider in computational microelectronics. So what else? We have Poisson equation, and also we can solve continuity equation. Continuity equation, or we can solve other more complicated equations in the computational electronics. But even in this case, even the simplest case, we have found that this is not that simple. So when we write down the equation, it looks like this. And this law, net charge density, is decomposed into hole contribution, electron contribution, and doping contribution. So it's okay. It is just a given number. However, in the case of equilibrium situation, now our hole and electron are dependent on the electrostatic potential. Its dependency is quite simple, exponentially dependent. So P is Ni times exponential minus phi over Vt. So that's simple. And electron density case, this is also Ni times exponential positive phi over Vt. If this rho is a constant, then we can treat it as a linear differential equation with respect to our unknown variable or unknown function phi. But since our source term rho itself is now a function of phi, therefore we cannot assume that this is a linear differential equation. Actually, this becomes a non-linear differential equation. In order to avoid this kind of difficulty from the beginning, so we have made a certain approximation. The first approximation we had introduced just to set it zero. So that was the source-free Poisson equation. After that, source-free Poisson equation is covered. After that, we introduce only a constant term. It was possible to solve it. I think that you are around here. Now, we have to go beyond this constant source term. We have to now consider the source term generated from our phi. So this one and this one should be considered. Since this is again a function of electrostatic potential, so its solution is not that easy. It is no longer a linear differential equation. I think that we have met a wall or barrier here. This is linear and non-linear. In order to go beyond this constant Poisson equation under the depletion approximation, we have to think about how can we solve a non-linear differential equation with a computer program. So that will be covered in our lecture 7. So when you have a look at our course progress, you see that first we just think about the infinite potential well, Just to give you a concrete example of discretization. So that was quite short. After that, up to now, we have discussed about Laplace equation and more generalized Poisson equation. However, our journey to the Poisson equation is not finished. Eventually, we should arrive at a state where we can solve the fully self-consistent Poisson equation. But point is, in order to reach this ultimate goal, we are around here and we have a barrier of non-linearity. Non-linearity. So, lecture 7 is devoted to address this specific issue only. After that, in lecture 8, we will immediately come back to our main discussion about the Poisson equation. So, we'll talk about the single variable case. So, the method is usually called the Newton method. So, without first introducing the theory, I wanted to just dive into our simple example. I like this example quite much. So let's just say that you wanted to solve a simple equation like this. So, of course, we know the solution. If I have to solve it, then I will just to say this is square of x equal to 1 and take the square root over this left hand side and right hand side, and I find that x can be plus minus 1. This is my procedure to solve this simple equation. But I was actually educated in this way. When I was a middle school student, so teacher, mathematics teacher, let me know the procedure. Okay, if you have this kind of a form, please leave all your terms in the right hand side and take the square root, then you will get the answer. That was his lesson for that problem. So I think that similar situation had happened to you, so now you can solve it. But let's just say that now we have to teach our computer programs, or our machine should be able to solve this problem. Then one way is just to mimic the way we are taught. So, okay, guys, please identify this number and that number. Then please move it to the right hand side and take square root. But you know that this is a very difficult for us to teach it to our machine. Also, you can find that this is not very general. So, how about this? If we have, for example, 2x minus 1 equal to 0, immediately it becomes more complicated. You know, in this case, also we have to find out, or we have to memorize something like this. Why we have to do that? So this is because we have a certain intention to make it to full power of x plus 2. And eventually we will have this term and take once again operation. If we have different terms in it, then we have to learn additional rule for make it to a second order or third or blah blah blah. So that will be quite tedious. And that limit, it's applicability. So we cannot apply this procedure to every problem. Instead of that, we have to invent a general way to that. So even without inspecting the equation itself, we should make a general way to solve it. So that is our motivation to study Newton method. Actually, our computer program don't have to worry about whether this is square x minus 1 or any other general equation can be solved. So anyway, let's go to our main discussion. You can easily understand the analytic solution is x positive minus 1. Mm-hmm. You can easily understand it. Our attempt is to develop a general way to solve it. So here we start from a guessed solution. Guessed solution x naught. So although the exact answer is plus minus 1, but actually from the beginning we have no knowledge on the real solution. Then we have to say we have a certain good guess on it. For example, let's say I just say this is 1000. Mm-hmm. Okay, we all understand this is quite much up from the real solution. Compared with plus minus 1, my guess is horrible. So 10 to the 3 is quite a large number compared with this plus minus 1. What is the way to quantify whether I'm quite close to the solution or quite off from the solution? I mean that, of course, number 1.001 and 10 to the 7, 1000, both of them are not solutions. You understand? So they are long. Big, and this is also long. Big, only one can be a correct solution. However, as you can easily understand, although 1.001 and 10 to the 3 are not solutions, but in numerical sense, this 1 plus 001 is much more desirable than 1000. If you have to choose two solutions for this equation, what will be your choice? Will you take 1000 or will you take 1.001? If I were you, then I would like to choose this number because this is quite close to 1. But point is, every discussion, our discussion up to now is related with the solution itself. So I say that I like 1 plus 001 because it is close to the real solution 1. I told you in that way. But there is a serious problem. It is now implicitly assuming that we know the solution. But if our equation becomes non-trivial, then we don't have any reliable guess on the real solution. Oh, so therefore, even when we have 1.001 and 10 to the 3, actually we have no idea which one is close to the real solution? Because we have no idea about real solution. Happen to be, if this real solution is, for example, 999, then obviously this 10 to the 3 is a more desirable solution. But whether one is good solution or 999 is a good solution, we have no answer before actually solving this problem itself. Since we have such a problem, we have to introduce a way whether our solution is good or not. I mean that we have to introduce a certain measure for the proximity of our solution to real solution. That is quite easily obtained by this way. If we evaluate this function itself, square of 1.001 minus 1, and when we evaluate the 10 to the 3 and its square minus 1, obviously this number will be much larger. And now we can say that since the evaluation of square of x minus 1, this one is much close to 0 than this one. That's the reason why we say 1.001 is a much better solution than 10 to the 3. Point is, now, in order to measure the quality of a solution, we can just evaluate the function like this. However, think about this one. Instead of this this form, now we have, for example, cube of x minus 1 equal to 3. In this case, what should be our evaluation in order to quantify our solution's error? Then we have to say actually this one. If this number is close to 0, then we will love it and we will call it as an approximate solution. But if this number is quite large and quite much off from the number 0, then we'll say that, oh, this is a quite bad guess for our equation. So let's say we have a certain general expression like r of x. We have to solve certain function r of x equal to 0. Then now we have a temporal solution like x naught. And in order to quantify whether this x naught is a good solution or not, can be easily quantified as just evaluating r of x naught. If this number is close to 0, then good, we have a good solution. And if its absolute value is much larger than 0, and that will give you a quite bad situation. So now we understand that in order to quantify our solution's quality, then it is quite easy. If we have to solve r of x equal to 0, if this is the solution or the equation we have to solve, only evaluating R of X naught is quite enough. Wow. So we are quite happy with this measure. And this measure is, this number is usually called as residue. We wanted to make the residue close to zero. If we have a residue quite close to zero, in turn, it means that our solution is also close to the solution. So say, for example, in our example, our x naught equal to, for example, 1 plus 10 to the minus 14. In this case, still, we don't have perfect solution. This is not exactly equal to number 1, the real solution. But what will happen when we evaluate x, r of x naught, then it will be just around 2 times 10 to the minus 14. And you know, 2 times 10 to the minus 14, we can treat it as a quite close number to 0, and we will quite happy with this 1 plus 10 to the minus 14. If we can get this solution, this number, instead of pushing our journey to the exact solution, if we have sufficiently small residue value, then we are all set. I will not further try to find out better solution. That is the usual way of this numerical calculation. In this course, we just try to find out a numerically sound solution or approximate solution. So now we have defined certain case. We have to solve R of X equal to 0. And we have a certain temporal solution, X naught. And unfortunately, when we evaluate a residue R of X naught, unfortunately, it is not 0. For example, let me give you a concrete example. R of X equal to square X minus 1 and X naught equal to 2 happen to be. So in this case, when we evaluate this number R of 2, we will have 4 minus 1 equal to 3. Certainly, this number is not 0 or not close to 0. So we say that X naught is unfortunately not a solution. If you have this case, now our goal is to improve it by adding certain correction. Let's say that this corrected solution is given by X naught plus a correction or an update called delta. So although our R of X naught was not 0, but our hope is when we insert this X naught plus delta into our residue function, then we hope that to have 0. So let's do it together in this specific example. I wanted to say introduce 2 plus delta and try to make R of 2 plus delta equal to 0. Why don't you do it together with me? Then what will happen? If we insert this 2 plus delta into our residue R, then we have to say square of 2 plus delta minus 1 equal to 0. Then that will give you delta square plus 4 delta plus 3 equal to 0. Okay, good. And you know that this delta give you minus 3 or minus 1 when you solve it. Then it simply means that you will have the real solution like minus 1 or 1. Perfect. Now you have generated the solution. But I wanted to stress that when compared with the difficulties of solving this equation and difficulty of solving this equation, there is no difference. If you can solve this equation without much difficulty, then you can also solve this equation without much difficulty. Although this procedure shown in the right part looks perfect, however, we have not improved the situation. In order to solve this modified equation for our delta, we should be able to solve a non-linear equation. So, it's not a way of improvement. Everything is just identical. This is just a reformulated equation. No simplification has been introduced. So this cannot be a solution. So let me come back to our original equation, more general equation here. So if we have to solve this equation for delta, then still the complexity of solving this equation is equal to or identical to solving this equation. So it's not possible for us to solve it. Instead of this one, instead of fully solving this non-linear equation, we wanted to introduce the most important step in this discussion. That here we have to introduce a step of linearization. We all understand R can be a non-linear function of X. This is a non-linear function. But how about the linearization? In the linearization, then we can set first the value itself and a coefficient finally have the small deviation. So this R can be now expressed as this form. For example, let me go to our specific example. In this case, we have to evaluate R 2 plus delta. Then that is given by actually square delta 4 delta plus 3. However, in the linearized form, then it can be approximated as 3 plus 4 delta. Of course, we have here square of delta, but since we have introduced the linearization step, so that is just neglected. In this case, in order to get this function or this form, we just evaluate it fully and neglect all other terms. But is there any way for us to directly arrive at this form? How can you do that? You can easily understand this number 3 appearing here as a value term is just corresponding to your R of number 2. Please note that when we have delta equal to 0, then we will have just zero contribution from this linear term. So it is quite acceptable for us. The value term, which does not depend on delta, should be evaluated just number 2, with number 2. And here we have delta. Then what will be the coefficient? What will be the meaningful coefficient for this delta term? And you can easily understand that is given by simply, so dr over d, in this case delta or dx, whatever. So we have to calculate the derivative which is evaluated at x equal to number 2. So let me just visualize it for you. We are now introducing an approximation of linearization. And if this is x and this is r over x, the function r over x just looks like this. This is the shape of our r over x. And we are now trying to find out the linearized form around x equal to 2. In this case, if we make the linearization, then we have to take the value here. This is corresponding to r of 2 and find out the slope here. This slope is corresponding to dr over dx but evaluated at number 2. Simply speaking, I wanted to say this can be expressed as simply r of 2 plus dr over dx evaluated number 2 times delta. So now let's go to our general case. Instead of number 2, we'll just keep x naught. Then after linearization, we will have r of x naught plus dr over dx, but evaluated at x equal to x naught. That is all for our linearization. Okay, so up to now, we have just made a linearization step to the left-hand side, and right-hand side was just to number 0, and we can keep the number 0. After that, we found that this form is a constant plus a coefficient delta equal to 0. We can solve it. The major difference between this linearization form and the original form is that this original form and linearized form is significant. This one, we cannot solve it. We can solve it. But here, now, we can solve it. That is really big difference. So, why don't you just solve it? Then, it is quite easy. Now, delta is simply given by minus r of x divided by dr over dx evaluated at x naught. Then, if we apply it to our specific example, then understand our equation is linearized. After the linearization, it becomes 3.4 delta equal to 0. And when we evaluate it, then delta becomes minus 3/4. So after having this delta, then we will say, we have assumed that instead of x naught plus delta is regarded as a better solution. That was our starting point. So we now believe that 2 minus 3/4, so 5/4, is better solution than the original one, number 2. This is our hope. And when you evaluate your residue, you will find that, of course, this is much better than this number. If our hope is satisfied or realized, then we can proceed with this number again. Okay, now we start from x naught equal to 5/4 and repeat this procedure. Then you will get even better solution. Same holds for the general case. Once you get the delta, then you construct x naught plus delta as your next temporal solution and use that temporal solution to evaluate the residue and calculate the slope and calculate an update. And that update is once again added to your temporal solution and improve until you are quite much satisfied your temporal solution. Now, it is important for you to fully understand this procedure. If you cannot understand this single variable case, then you cannot expand it to multivariable case, multivariable and multi-equation case. So let me quickly generalize it to multivariable, multi-equation case. Then, quite similar to our previous discussion, let me give you a concrete example. So we now have three variables. So therefore we have three equations. So instead of solving one single equation for one single variable, now we have three multiple variables and multiple equations. Generally, we assume that the number of variables and number of equations are the same. Otherwise, we cannot have the determined system. So, we have the same number for unknown variables and equations. And let's say this is the equation at your hand. Now, you have three variables. And the first equation is just a linear combination of your phi's and non-linear term of your phi 1. And second one is also having certain linear combination. Third one has also linear combination. Up to here, this is linear. But since you have introduced non-linear terms on your phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, it is no longer a linear system. It becomes a completely non-linear system. You have to solve it. Of course, solving it by analytic mean is not that easy. So therefore, we have to rely on our numerical solution. Then, how can we find the solution by using a numerical means? We will just start from certain guess on the solution vector. Now we have to introduce solution vector and say that we have 0 and 0 and 0. These zeros represent that this is not the exact solution but our temporal solution. Then obviously when we insert these three values into it, then there is no hope that we have 0, the equality, and equality. Let's assume on a lucky case. Now we have randomly selected three numbers and just insert them into our f1 function, f2 function, f3 function. And evaluation result happen to be equal to 0 and 0 and 0. What does it mean? That means that by our great luck, we have found the solution immediately. But do you have such kind of luck in your life? Maybe not. So usually we assume that even when we have a certain solution vector, when we have a certain solution vector, usually the R of this solution vector cannot be a null vector. So I have introduced a shorthanded form for our F1 evaluation, F2 evaluation, F3 evaluation. This R simply means that it takes a vector and generate a vector. Internally, it just evaluate this R of our vector simply means that F1, F2, F3, and our three unknown variables. That is the role of our R, mapping R. Taking the vector and generate another vector whose element or whose entry is either F1, F1, F2, or F3. Okay? So, let's say now we have such a kind of a residue vector. Previously, that was just a residue. However, now it is a vector, so we frequently call it as a residue vector. Sometimes we just call it as residue. Okay? So since our residue vector is not a null vector, that's the reason why we don't have a solution. So the goal is to minimize the R or make our R residue close to null vector. So I mean that if R equal to 0, 0, and 1 million, that cannot be a solution. We wanted to have something like 10 to the minus 14, 10 to the minus 14, or 10 to the minus 14. Usually, this situation in numerical analysis, this situation is regarded as a much better case for the solution. You can easily understand. These are regarded as a numeric error, but if you have a component which is significantly varies from 1 or 0, then this usually this means that our solution is quite off from the real solution. Then how can you proceed? It's quite easy. So let's say that we have a certain vector phi not vector, and we wanted to introduce now delta vector. So delta 1, delta 2, and delta 3 to correct phi 1, phi y2 and y3. So by adding element wise delta 1, delta 2, delta 3 to our initial guess vector, then we hope that this result is much better than previously. So simply speaking, how about this? When we compare the R evaluated with our finite vector and compare it with the phi R plus delta vector, if we can calculate the, for example, norm of this vector and norm of this vector, we hope that our updated vector gives much smaller latitude than the original solution vector. That is our hope, and we wanted to make it. So let's do it together. In the next slide, I have summarized it. So our goal is to find out phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. So a solution vector. This equality with a null vector guarantee that we have the solution. Of course, we have no solution from the beginning. So we start from a temporal solution or initial guess, and just to insert them, then we have a vector, latitude vector, which is not equal to the null vector. So we wanted to make R small. So now we introduce update vector, and by adding this update vector to our original initial guess, then still we hope that having the null vector. Once again, let me stress that if we can solve this equation exactly, then everything will be perfect. However, the difficulty of solving this equation is equivalent to solving this equation. So still cannot solve this equation. So after that, after realizing this is not that easy exactly, so now we have introduced an assumption of linearization. So of course, this linearization can be applied when the update vector is quite small. So implicitly, we are now assuming that delta phi is not that large. That is our assumption, but anyhow, we should live with it. By using the linearization, we can make this form. Please make a comparison with this upper line and lower line. Right-hand side is kept as before, and the left-hand side is now expanded with the linearization. What happened to the linearization? We first keep the constant term or value term and generate the coefficient and the deviation. In this case, if we apply this argument to our form, this is corresponding to the value itself. Value evaluated at no fluctuation or perturbation. So when these delta values are set to be zero, then we will have just the value. factor of value, and you know that this is exactly corresponding to our residue factor. And now we have a matrix which is corresponding to our coefficient. Previously, when we had only one variable and one equation, there was a certain coefficient. However, since now we have three equations and three unknown variables, therefore the coefficient now should be as a matrix. So now we have a matrix, and its size is corresponding to n by n, where n is the number of equation and number of unknown variable. So we will revisit this this matrix shortly after. And now we have perturbation or small deviation itself. This is a coefficient, and this is our correction or update. So previously we consider an update a number, but since now it is a vector, now we have to call it as a update vector. So let me simply write down. Now our linearized form is given by residue vector plus a certain matrix multiplied by our update vector should be a null vector. That is the form we have to keep in mind. Then, so you can easily understand the meaning of this residue vector and this update vector. So only remaining difficulty is to understand this matrix. And this matrix has its own name, and this is quite a famous matrix. This matrix is Jacobian matrix. So as you can see, when you just evaluate it, you can find that now Jacobian matrix is I comma j term. So I's row and j's column component of our Jacobian matrix is simply given by round Fi round Phi j. This is 1, 1 component, 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, 2, 2, 3. So this is corresponding to the row index, and this is corresponding to column index. So you can easily evaluate the Jacobian matrix following the definition given here. Let me just do it together with me. Let me just do it. So since our function is given here, if I am asked to generate the Jacobian matrix itself, I will do it like this. Since we have three unknown variables and three equations, we will get 3x3 matrix. And the first component should be round F1 over round Phi1. Then please do it. When we take the partial derivative of F1 function with respect to find one, then I can find that from this one we have minus 2, and from this one I have just minus exponential phi 1. And here we have 1 comma 2 component, and this is our f1 function should be partial derivative with respect to phi 2. Since we have just phi 2 here, we have just number 1. And here we have 0 coefficient for phi 3. So 1 comma 3 component should be just 0. Let me do it quickly with you for other rows. For example, this was the first row. And for second row, we have to take the derivative of f2 phi 1. So it just gives 1. Here we have 1. And phi 2, here we have minus 2. And this term, so e to the phi 2. And phi 3, here we have just phi 3. So number 1. And finally, for the third row, we have to take, there is no dependencies on phi 1, so we have just 0. And phi 2, only linear term. So finally, phi 3, that gives you minus 2 and minus exponential phi 3. Of course, this number 4 plus 4 always vanishes when we take the partial derivative. So this is the Jacobian matrix. If you have a different equation to be solved, then you will have a different Jacobian. So now you have the explicit form of a Jacobian matrix, and I have prepared the MATLAB example. Due to the time limitation, I have stopped here. But in our preview lecture 6.5, then I have shown to you more detailed about MATLAB example. So if you are curious, then please visit the video preview lecture 6.5. Okay, so let me just dive into our solution. In this case, we start from this 1, 2, 3 as an initial guess. So 1, 2, 3, I just made it. There is no certain principle to make this phi not better. I just say 1, 2, 3, 1, 1, 1, 3, 2, 1, any one is just okay. And after that, after 10 Newton iterations, we found this number. This vector. So, you know, this vector is quite difficult to find by just luck. Since we have numerical solution, we have numerical analysis too, then we can find this good solution. Okay, you can easily feel that even with these three numbers, three unknown variable and three equation, it is already beyond the human's ability. For you or for me, it would be almost impossible to calculate this number exactly. However, with simple programming, you can get the solution. I think that we are quite lucky living in these days. And now you have homework. And although we have talked about the multi-variable, multi-equation case in this homework number 7, I'm just giving you a simple equation with a single variable phi, and this is only one equation to be solved. So please read this homework. And that is actually related with our computational microelectronics. This equation is used to generate the initial guess for our Poisson equation. In next lecture 8, We will try to solve the Poisson equation, and this equation will be the basis for setting the initial guess of the Poisson equation. So that's the reason why I have prepared this seemingly almost trivial example. So please prepare your report by next Monday morning. Okay, I think that that's it for our lecture 7. And so let me just wrap up with this lecture with your comments or questions.